Hello friends, this is Dr. Kostubh Bondre. We are here to discuss the important points and the key takeaways from editorials in today's newspaper, The Hindu, 6th June. Before moving forward, I would like to request you to subscribe to this channel and like this video at the end. I also want you to answer to the question that I will pose at the end of this presentation. The first news or the first editorial that we look at now is about plastics. We know that yesterday the whole globe celebrated the World Environment Day. The theme of United Nations was Beat Plastic Pollution. Now it has been recognized as a grave threat to the entire globe. Point is, India is one of the countries which is a leader, unfortunately, in polluting the atmosphere, not just atmosphere, the hydrosphere and the lithosphere with plastics. So this is in contravention to the rules that the government has framed itself. Solid waste management rules and the plastic waste management rules 2016. For examination, you need to prepare both of this and you can get questions on this rules and the modifications or implementation thereof. Next, Center's own estimates show that over 60% of nearly 25,000 tons of plastic waste generated daily is collected. Now, even going by this estimate, it is clear that nearly 10,000 tons of trash is being released into the environment and a lot is going into the sea. Because whatever we release, most of the settlements are located on the coastal areas which are very densely populated, and whatever plastic pollution is generated, that is, ends up ultimately into the sea. For all those areas which are continental in their location, from there also the rivers carry these waste to the sea. Ganga, Brahmaputra, Meghna system is on the UN map of 10 rivers worldwide that collectively carry the bulk of plastic waste into the ocean. Now you understand how serious this problem is. We know that plastics are not biodegradable. Most of the plastics are use and throw. Most of the items like straws, cutlery, they are just, we use it once and throw it away. This is a major problem with plastic pollution. The effects are evident. The effects are mentioned here. One key word I would like to highlight is microplastics. Now, there are many plastic particles that are present in cosmetics. For example, the face wash scrubs. So these microplastics, they go into the sewage and then carry ultimately reach the sea. These are something that cannot be collected or processed also. They are invisible mostly to the naked eye. And what happens is when they enter the ocean, you know the concepts of bioaccumulation, bioconcentration, biomagnification. So these are microplastics particles which enter the food chain and then they pollute the entire oceans, marine life, and through the food chain they go on accumulating, bioaccumulation, in the higher trophic levels. So this is a very big hazard that needs to be taken care of. Incidentally, these microplastics, their use in cosmetics has been banned in countries like United States. However, in India, we are yet to take the lead. Next, the legislation that you need to be prepared with is the Environmental Protection Act, 1986. Then regulation should help stop manufacture single-use plastics. Presently, you know, many state governments in India are banning plastics, especially the plastics which are, the criteria is 50 microns thickness. Now, biodegradable materials are being brought in, right? Innovation is being brought in to replace plastic materials. Now, you also need to prepare about Central Pollution Control Board. Very recently, there was a question in UPSC prelims about it. Then local bodies, the role of local bodies, because it is at the local level that the local bodies need to take care of this pollution. But it is found that they are very inefficient in terms of plastic waste collection, segregation, and their processing. The state level monitoring committees are present. So this is, see, here in this paragraph, the newspaper highlights all the drawbacks in the present system of handling of plastics in India. So this is mentioned here, the waste management framework is dysfunctional. Now, when the question comes in mains on this issue, I would like to give you a case study. This case study is about an olive ridley turtle that was caught by marine biologist on a boat near Costa Rica. So there was, you know, on YouTube also, there's a video where the plastic straw is struck in the nose of that type of green turtle, and then that is removed very painfully. So such case studies about that Costa Rica olive ridley turtle, you can mention in the examination. And do not forget the keywords of bioconcentration, accumulation, or biomagnification. With this, we move to the next issue. The next issue is about the recently concluded or the Shangri-La dialogue, which is held in Singapore. Here, our Prime Minister spoke about ASEAN, he spoke about India's vision and overall gave broad contours of Indian foreign policy. This article tries to tell us that how there is a shift in the way India conducts its foreign policy or has been conducting foreign policy since a couple of years. Basically, when we speak about Indian foreign policy, understand that initially India stood for non-aligned movement. After the fall of Soviet Union, 1991, disintegration of Soviet Union, India slowly and steadily gravitated towards, say, Russia. And then after 2010, we've seen, or rather 2005, India has been moving towards United States of America. This shift towards US was much more pronounced when the present dispensation, BJP dispensation, came to the center. There were certain areas where we could work with US. The factors were, for example, the Quad, or it is called the Quadrilateral. Second, it was the Malabar exercises in the Indian Ocean. Third was the agreements that, strategic agreements that we have been signing with US. For example, the BECA, SISMOA, the Logistics Supports Agreement, LSA, right? Plus the US support to India in global multilateral fora. For example, the MTCR, WASENAR, Australia grouping, and now the lobbying that is being done for entry into NSG. Apart from that, on Iran issue also, we could see that somehow India, because of the suitability of interest also, right, that we also did not want Iran to go nuclear, especially when already Pakistan in the region is a nuclear power. So here also, on the issue of Iran, somehow it has been seen that India has been even not very willingly following the US line. However, after all this, US recently named the Indo-Pacific region, this Asia, East Asia, and the region as Indo-Pacific. And you know that the military document of United States of America, very recently it was released, in that, during Obama's time, it quoted India as pivot to Asia, America's pivot to Asia. So to counterbalance Russia and China especially, US sees India as a strategic asset in Asia. We are a part of arc of democracy, the term which was coined by George Bush, right? The arc of democracy, in this excess of evil, and this excess of evil was Iran, China, and so on, right? So in this context, presently, there are certain things which have made our government to rethink on our proximity with United States of America. Because of our proximity to United States of America, the unintended consequences have been the strengthening of Russia and Pakistan relationship, which is to the detriment of India, because Russia steadfastly has been supporter of India throughout. Russia is one of the largest supplier of defense equipment to India. So in this case, it becomes very difficult for India if Russia goes to Pakistan. Third, the next factor is the rise of China and its belligerence, because China sees the emergence of this axis of democracy and the Quad or the Indo-Pacific as a threat to its own autonomy or its own sovereignty. So it senses this danger, and that is why it is behaving belligerently or aggressively towards India. Considering this, there have been other factors also which have resulted into India taking a rethink on its proximity to US. The first and foremost has been the rise of Donald Trump. Donald Trump has made American policy very uncertain and very unpredictable. Anyway, America has been following, as Henry Kissinger always says, or it was Henry Kissinger's statement, America does not have permanent friends or foes. America only has permanent interests. So the policy of use and throw, America uses a country for its own interest and then abandons it. That it did it with Libya, it did with Pakistan is a very recent example. Afghanistan, we also know that case of Afghanistan. So India has been rethinking. Other issue has been the issue of diaspora in US, the issue of visas. So because of this, and the IT sector of India is suffering because of the policies of Donald Trump, in the light of these issues, we can very well understand that now, originally NAM meant for non-alignment, but now the government is moving towards multi-alignment. We are speaking to US, we are speaking to Russia, we are speaking to China. There have been informal summits at Wuhan and Sochi very recently with the presidents of China and Russia, with Indian Prime Minister. So throughout, what is India is trying to do is India is trying to balanced approach in the foreign policy. Ultimately, the most important determinant of foreign policy of any country has to be the national interest. And it is in the national interest that India follows the keystone principle of strategic autonomy in framing its foreign policy. So while I have said this, I would like to highlight that there is a difference between what we follow in terms of strategic autonomy of foreign policy. We are not China, we are not Russia, and we are not US. Though we say that national interest is prime, India always has kept this national interest in harmony with human rights and ethical principles, even globally. So our national interest is not counter to the global interests. So after that, I'll just show you the highlighted points here. You can go through this. See, free and open Indo-Pacific, the UN and FATF, all these are keywords that you need to prepare for the examination. Questions can be expected on any of these groupings. Then the concept of strategic autonomy, I have already spoken about it. The Bandung spirit of 1955, now Bandung conference was the origin of NAM. So that you need to keep in mind. The concept of Indo-Pacific, you can get a question on this. Next is the 7-point vision for Indo-Pacific region that was unveiled by the Prime Minister of India very recently. We have to prevent this great power rivalries. Now this is like Cold War 2.0. So we have to prevent this. The importance and centrality of ASEAN as a grouping for India. You can get a question on this also. Departure from transactionalism. Now this is one of the drawbacks of American foreign policy presently with respect to Trump as president. Trump is a businessman. That is why this transactionalism and pragmatism that has hurt India, because you can't count on Trump. It's a simple give and take, right? The shifting plates of global politics and fault lines of history. In this, India has to maneuver its own national interest, right? Keeping in mind the larger global interest of the global community. So this is a very wonderful article about foreign policy. Next, we move to the issue of governance in public sector or governance in banking sector, sorry. And this is private as well as public. The tipping point is presently the drama at ICICI Bank. You know, the involvement at the issue of conflict of interest with respect to the CEO Chanda Kochar of ICICI Bank. Now, I've highlighted the important points here. I'll just need to first tell you the key points that you need to be prepared with. First, when it comes to the governance of banking sector, you have to be prepared with the Basel norms, BASEL, the Basel norms. Second, what are the guidelines of RBI on governance in banks? Third, it is the committee that RBI had set up in 2014, and the report came in 2015. It was PJ Nayak committee report on governance in public sector banks. You need to be prepared with this. Also, there are certain key points regarding banking sector like NPAs, the non-performing assets. Then it is the twin balance sheet problem of the Indian banking system that was very detailed, in detail dealt with in the economic survey. You need to prepare that also. This issue is related to your syllabus. It is corporate governance. That point is mentioned. After that, it is also in paper 4, ethics. We can see speak about the conflict of interest. So this can be a very good case study. I would like to say that having conflict of interest is not a problem. For ethics, you should be very clear that if you are in a powerful position and there emerges a conflict of interest, it's not in itself a problem. The problem is when the conflict of interest is not acknowledged, is not transparently brought out, and is not communicated. So wherever there is conflict of interest, you should acknowledge that interest and recuse yourself from that position for that particular on that particular issue. So that shows ethical approach. Here, keywords again are whistleblower. There is an act. There was a question on that Whistleblower Protection Act. You can go through that. Banking governance, it is systemically, and this is our keyword, systemically important banks. Now, there was a term brought at DSIBs, domestically systemically important banks by RBI. You need to prepare that. As institution or organization, you need to prepare RBI, SEBI. Then, what is the case at this ICICI? That case is mentioned here. It is about the issue at the heart of controversy was, if there was conflict of interest, the CEO, Mrs. Kochar, should have brought it out and recused from all matters concerning Videocon. So she did not do it. Non-disclosure of conflict of interest and non-recusal are grave enough lapses. So that is highlighted here. About conflict of interest, even more it is mentioned, and then breakdown in governance at the banking system. So this is the health of the banking system is very crucial for economic growth to occur in a country, right? So this issue is very important, especially for paper 3. Prepare it nicely. Next, it is about health. I would like to highlight that there are two keywords when we speak about health. In India, we see a confluence of or coexistence of communicable as well as non-communicable diseases. When we speak about non-communicable diseases, undernutrition and overnutrition both coexist. Undernutrition and overnutrition both are types of malnutrition. But in India, you see obesity coexisting with malnutrition. So this is the context in which this article has to be seen. Along with technical details, what is important is the policy decisions where we can, the government as a policymaker can make decisions which can take care of the health of the larger population. So let us see what the keywords are. First, you need to understand what is nutrition. Second, the concepts like wasting and stunting. Here it is mentioned stunting. So wasting is like weight for height ratio. So wasting shows acute malnutrition. Stunting is height for age. So if the height is less for particular age, it is chronic malnutrition. It is a representative of chronic malnutrition. Then the statistics are mentioned here. How many people in India are obese? How many people are undernourished? Everything is mentioned here. And the record is very unfortunate. India also needs to move from concept of food security. Now, yesterday we discussed an article of National Food Security Act. So we need to move from concept of food security to nutrition security, because understand that even if the population is getting adequate food, it is not necessary that they are absorbing that food in their gut. Plus, whatever the food is available, it is not necessary that it is a balanced diet which will take care of micronutrients or rather hidden hunger. So these are the keywords I would like you to prepare. Then overweight, obesity, wasting, stunting, again keywords. With obesity, the diseases most commonly associated are the chronic diseases like cardiovascular diseases, related to heart, atherosclerosis. Then it is diabetes and some types of cancers, even liver disease like fatty liver. So this research shows that Indians are susceptible to such diseases. Government is speaking about universal health coverage, so that context has to be brought in here. Indian children eat more junk and they are becoming increasingly sedentary. So this is a very serious issue. Then the criteria is waistlines. The measurement of waistlines gives us an idea about obesity. Then recently the context is even Kerala had brought a fat tax in the recent past. So the sugar taxes and mass media campaigns. So media and legislation, these are the two most important tools. We need to create public awareness, because this issue is about lifestyle. Behavioral change is needed. So the seriousness is highlighted at even United Nations. Then the Delhi High Court decision to ban junk food in school premises, that is very crucial. Agriculture systems can also be modified to increase crop diversity. This is present in your paper 3, right? Crop diversity, so that the dietary diversity and regulatory and fiscal measures are used. Lancet study is given. You can quote such studies in GS as well as essays. Reverse the stigma attached to obesity in the society. And then universal health coverage. Here the writer also highlights that the cost of healthcare becomes excessive for obese patients or such lifestyle disease patients. So this out-of-pocket expenditure has also a very negative impact, because see, this is a cycle that the person, that the author is speaking about. What is this cycle? Person is obese, disease, the person gets a disease, then there is hospitalization or out-of-pocket expenditure that results into poverty, poverty results into disease, and then unemployment. And this disease, unemployment, poverty, these three become a cycle, and it becomes very difficult to break it. So here the role of government becomes very crucial, and public health care becomes very crucial. So tackling obesity benefits the economy as well as the environment. So in this is the article. Next, we move to the next article, which is about the book release, a new book that has been brought out by the former chief of RAW, and it's together with ISI also. Pakistani intelligence officer Durrani and this AS Dulat both have written a book. It is The Spy Chronicles, RAW, ISI and The Illusion of Peace. Now, I will not go into the details of the book. What is crucial when we discuss Kashmir is the crux of this article is India and Pakistan both are locked up into this aggression mode. In this, India's hard stand, especially in the Kashmir, has not given peace. What has happened is, it has alienated the people of Kashmir. Second, the political leadership of Kashmir has become defunct. Third, there is a lot of anger in the people of Kashmir. Fourth, Pakistan's meddling into Kashmir is creating complicated scenario in Kashmir where peace has become elusive. Now, the key words here highlighted are the need to listen to the Huriyat. So the bottom line is, we need to open a dialogue with Pakistan on one hand, and second, with all representative factors of Kashmir, political representative factors of Kashmir, we need to speak to them and engage them in a dialogue so that peace is established in the valley. The writer goes to the extent of saying that we should also have a permanent dialogue between India and Pakistani intelligence and invite the Pakistan Army Chief for talks in India. Keywords here are 2003, ceasefire agreement, go through it. The operation all out that was carried by that is being carried by India, so that hard stance is taken on militancy, radicalization, and so on. The cycle is mentioned here: tough action and healing touch. We try to do that, but then the key point is the political representation of Kashmiris. So if the politicians in Kashmir do not reach out to people, do not speak for peace, there is a vacuum set in, and that vacuum is then fulfilled by elements which are anti-national and anti-peace, like stone pelting. Need to find to speak. I mean, what India says is we need to find people to speak in Pakistan and in Kashmir. So the refrain that we do not know whom to speak to, that has to be given away. We need to create leadership in Kashmir. We need to speak to them. We need to nurture such dialogue with Pakistan also. Need to be kept engaged at all times. Now, there was another book that is mentioned here. Just go through that. It is very clear. Even I have been to Kashmir and stayed in the valley for 10 days. Kashmir, ordinary Kashmiri, doesn't want to go to Pakistan. They know what Pakistan is, a failing state. They don't want to be a part of that sinking boat. But the point is, when they speak about Azadi, that Azadi has very different connotations for different people. We may interpret it as accommodation, dignity, honor, and justice. So some sort of autonomy and the expression of Kashmiriyat, Insaniyat, and Jamhuriyat is required in this in the dialogue. Next, New Delhi only wants to talk to us when there is trouble. So this is what we also observe, that when Kashmir is burning, at that time we become serious about dialogue. That should not be the case. There should be a sustained effort to evolve a political dialogue with Kashmiri people, their representatives, so that peace is maintained. The author also supports this. The Kashmiri is craving for peace and looking for someone to talk to. Kashmiriyat, which is, you know, Kashmir is cradle of Sufism. They're peace-loving people, wonderful people. So this Kashmiriyat has to be highlighted, and that has to be used to establish a dialogue with humanism at the core. So radicalism is a big problem. This is a keyword you need to prepare, and how to stop radicalization of youth in Kashmir. Then must bring back the Kashmiri Pandits, very crucial for re-establishing the human ethos in Kashmir Valley. It has to be a gradual one. There was a controversy about separate colonies, but the author is supporting it. Permanent enmity with India and Pakistan, it's not in interest. Even the higher leadership in both the countries believes this. But then it is also true that whenever we try to go for peace, there is something wrong happens. So these are the deep state of Pakistan. That is a connotation for ISI and the army, that they want to sabotage any dialogue, because anti-India sentiment needs to be kept alive in Pakistan for army and ISI to be relevant and abrogate all power illegally. So, but then it is very clear that from the point of view of India, we do not want a war with Pakistan. We want peace, and then we should try for that. Author also supports NSA level dialogue. Presently it is going on, but he supports dialogue not only at the level of NSA, but also army chiefs or chiefs of ISI. The issue of Kulbushan Jadhav, Indian person who was caught in Pakistan on the allegation that he was a spy, just go through that issue. He is presently in Pakistan. Keyword here is track to negotiation. This is people to people, not government to government, because when government to government speaks, it's in media limelight. So many times they are not able to speak freely and give concessions. But at people to people level, away from the glare of media, peace can emerge very quickly. And then the issue of Mumbai trial, which has been prolonged in Pakistan. We need Pakistan to bring Hafiz Saeed to justice. So this is about India and Pakistan and Kashmir issue. The next article here, again, is about India and Pakistan. Here, the article is trying to point out that we and Pakistan, having partitioned in 1947, have moved through different trajectories. India has become a secular, democratic country, republic country, where diversity is celebrated. On the other hand, Pakistan, because of the roots of Muslim League initially, has gone a very violent way, which has destabilized the country and made it into a failing state. So the details are mentioned here. We should thank Jawaharlal Nehru and his vision, the first Prime Minister of India, which made India a very peaceful country that we have today. It's the doctrine of civilian supremacy, and the army has been kept in check. So non-political nature of armed forces is very crucial for democracy to sustain. That is not the case with Pakistan. So things are mentioned here. The exclusivist ideology, secularism, this is the difference between Pakistani ideology and Indian ideology. So the author here tries to relate it to the present state of affairs in Indian politics, where majoritarianism is somehow, the tinge of majoritarianism is feared that it is taking place, and somehow army people after retirement are joining politics, and domestic problems are being solved with the help of army. So this is not a very good case, and we should refrain from bringing or giving any space to in the domestic politics to the Indian Armed Forces. Army should belong to where it army should be placed where it belongs, the barracks or the border, right? Not the streets in the country. Clear? So this is about India Pakistan. Having discussed this, I give you a question. Write a short note on geopolitics of the Indian Ocean. Giving suitable example, highlight the factors that pose a threat to maintaining Indian Ocean as a zone of peace. So do comment on this question, write your answers, send me the answers, and I'll give you my opinion. This is all from my side for today. Have a very nice day. Happy studying. Thank you.